Let us start a fresh module. This is on testing, improvement and parameter extraction. So far, we have covered the following steps of MOSFET modeling. Let me put here the abbreviation for the procedure for MOSFET modeling. In fact, this is an abbreviation which applies to any device, right? So, for the MOSFET, we have covered the structure and characteristics, the qualitative model, then equations, boundary conditions, approximations, solutions. In this module, we are going to cover testing, improvement and parameter extraction, TIP. At the end of this module, you should be able to explain how the threshold based model is improved with the help of smoothing functions to get the Buckley simulation model, BSIM model. Then you should be able to explain how threshold voltage VT, the parameter phi T, flat band voltage VFB, body effect parameter gamma and the effective mobility parameters are extracted from measurements. This is phi suffix T. Then you should be able to describe the evolution of the MOSFET model or MOSFET models for circuit simulation. So, once again here this is phi suffix T. Let us start with the testing step. We recall from the module on the procedure for device modeling that the solution is tested for the following criteria, namely generality, continuity, accuracy, physical basis and simplicity over the entire range of interest. And we abbreviate this criteria as GCAPS. Let us apply this criteria to our models on surface potential based model and threshold based model and see how they fare. Here is a surface potential based model summary. As we can see from here that although we have derived this model for a bulk MOSFET, in principle we could extend this MOSFET model to even smaller geometry devices. The central feature of this model is the calculation of the surface potential and then substitution of the surface potential into the expression for drift and diffusion currents. Okay? So, if we can modify this expression to include effects of small geometry, then I could calculate the surface potential using this modified expression and then apply it to these currents and then get the currents. Okay? Similarly for the mobility expressions here. So, in principle this approach is very general. Okay? With small modifications you can extend it to small geometry devices even though it has been derived for a bulk MOSFET. Let us look at continuity. This model is continuous. As we have remarked, the surface potential as a function of channel voltage as well as the gate to bulk voltage is a continuous function. Okay? It is a saturating function for psi s as a function of channel voltage V as well as psi s as a function of VGB. So, we can get continuous expressions across all regions, weak inversion, strong inversion, okay, moderate inversion and so on, and also saturation, non-saturation. Right? So, this model is continuous. Next comes accuracy. This model is accurate. As we have discussed, the Pausau model is indeed an accurate model, and then its approximation, namely the Bruce model, charge sheet model, is also a fairly accurate model. So then comes physical basis. You can see here there. You can see here that there are really no empirical parameters in this model except let us say this parameter n, okay, and maybe to an extent this electric field E naught, critical electric field E naught is empirical. But otherwise, if you run through these equations and see each of these terms, all these terms have physical basis, okay. Even the term E naught here has a physical basis, right, but its value is not derived from very fundamental theory. Similarly, the value for the parameter n here, okay. So there are a few empirical constants and parameters here, but then by and large this model has a strong physical basis. So final thing is simplicity S. The problem with this model is that its expressions look simple, but when you try to evaluate the surface potential expression, right, then you run into difficulties because this is an implicit expression and you have to do a lot of computation to derive the surface potential psi s for any given BGB and channel voltage V, okay, or surface or source to bulk voltage VSB and drain to bulk voltage VDB, okay. So that is a problem with this model. It is computationally intensive and therefore we cannot say it is computationally simple, okay. So that is its problem. As we have remarked in the previous module, that if you want to have a model for circuit simulation purposes, it should be computationally simple, because in circuit simulation we are trying to solve equations for hundreds of transistors simultaneously, and unless the equation for each transistor is simple, the computation involved in simulating a circuit would be enormous. Let us look at the threshold based model. How does this fare on the GCAPS criteria? Now, is this model general? Well, it is not general to the extent the surface potential based model is. That is because, you know, this is threshold based model. As we will see in a later module, the threshold voltage for small geometry devices is affected by many phenomena. So you cannot use this simple expression to predict the threshold voltage. That is one of the issues, okay. So this model cannot be easily applied to small geometry and other devices as it is, okay. It requires more modifications. Similarly, if you want to apply this model to, let us say, SOI based MOSFET, okay, and so on, it will not be that simple, okay. Surface potential based model, on the other hand, with less number of modifications can be extended to other device structures like SOI MOSFETs and things like that. So this model is not that general, so it does not fare well on the generality criterion. It fares miserably in the next criterion, namely the continuity criterion, because as we have seen here, as we have seen in an earlier module, that the drift current expression of this model is valid for VGS greater than VH, while the diffusion current expression is valid for VGS less than V dash T. So what happens between V dash T and VH? We do not have an expression. This is really the moderate inversion region, okay. So we do not have an expression there. So there is a gap, it is a serious gap, okay, in this model. So it does not work for all regimes of operation. Let us look at other criteria. Let me put down the abbreviation for the criteria here so that we do not forget. The next criterion we should look at is accuracy. Now definitely, if this model cannot work for moderate inversion region, right, then it is not accurate, because in that region it cannot really predict anything, okay. In other regimes of operation, it predicts currents reasonably well, okay. Physical basis. Well, this model is more or less physical, right. There are not many empirical parameters here as compared to the surface potential based model. So N and E naught are used even in this model as in surface potential based model. So there is some amount of empiricism here, but if you consider the other expressions, right, here, you go through all these expressions, you will find most of the terms here, right, have physical basis, they have physical meaning and they are not purely empirical parameters, which they are not purely empirical parameters which are adjusted for achieving match with the measured data. What about simplicity criterion? Well, this model fares quite well on the simplicity criterion. You look at this, that all its expressions, this expression here, the expression for saturation voltage, right, and so on, all these expressions, even the expressions for mobility, these are all closed form solutions, right. In other words, the amount of computation involved in this model is much smaller than in surface potential based model. That is what is the advantage of this model. We have highlighted this fact in our previous module. That is why circuit simulation based models have tended to be threshold based, right. Now, if we can somehow improve this model so that we cover the moderate inversion regime of operation between Vt dash and Vh, okay. So, between this Vt dash and Vh, for gate source voltages between Vt dash and Vh, then this model would be really good. And we should ensure that when we bridge this gap, our model remains continuous. Another thing if we can do, here we find that you have separate segments for VDS less than VDS sat and VDS greater than VDS sat. So, even here if we can somehow remove this partitioning, okay, then we will get a continuous model. So, this model, this threshold based model, which suffers on the G and C criteria and to an extent on the A criteria, right. So, G, C, A, it suffers on these three criteria. If somehow we can overcome this limitation by doing some modification, then this model would be really good, okay, for circuit simulation purposes. Let us look at some other criteria on which models are tested. So, criteria for physical basis of the solution. We said that a model should have a physical basis. So, how do you test the physical basis of a model? First thing you do is dimensional correctness check, right? And then you also try to see whether for large voltages and small voltages and so on, the model reduces to some simple expressions that we already know, right? This is how you check limiting cases. Let us apply these checks, okay, to our threshold based model. So, dimensional correctness, okay. Let us choose any one expression here and then try to see the dimensional correctness. Let us take the drain to source current expression for a diffusion. I am choosing this particular expression for illustration because most students are familiar with the square law expression, right. So, when they are asked to write the square law expression, they will not have a problem, right. But the diffusion current expression, students are not familiar because first level course normally does not discuss diffusion current. So, how do you, you know, remember the diffusion current expression based on dimensions? So, let us use the square law expressions as a guideline. Then we know that the right hand side of this IDS expression consists of the W by L ratio, aspect ratio of the MOSFET. This is dimensionless, then a mobility term, then a capacitance term and square of voltage. So, we know that when you multiply mobility by capacitance and square of voltage, you get current, okay. So, let us quickly check this. Mobility is centimeter square per volt second, capacitance is farad per centimeter and voltage square. So, one voltage term cancels here 1 centimeter term cancels here. Farad into volt is charge, coulombs divided by seconds. So, coulomb per second is amperes. Okay. Now, we are left with 1 centimeter term. Okay. Now, where is the problem? So, what we have done is, we have written the capacitance term as farad per centimeter, which is wrong. Actually, it should be farad per centimeter square. Okay. So, now the centimeter square cancels with this centimeter square and we are left with amperes. So, this is what we need to remember. So, you have an expression for current in terms of product of mobility, a capacitance and voltage square. Let us look at the diffusion current expression in this slide. So, you have the WIL aspect parameter, you have the mobility parameter and the capacitance term is the depletion capacitance. This capacitance term is analogous to Cox here. And then you have some exponential terms here which people might forget, but they can remember that these terms are dimensionless. So, what are in the exponents people might forget, but they should remember that these exponential terms have no dimensions and therefore, you are left with only the square of the voltage term analogous to this particular term in the drift current expression. And that square of the voltage term is the thermal voltage square term. Okay. Okay. After that, one can remember that in the exponential, you should get the gate source bias and the drain source bias, because otherwise there are no biases, right, in the terms that have appeared here so far. And when you get those terms, since they should be dimensionless because they are in the exponent, you know that the normalizing voltage would be thermal voltage. So, that is how you are sure that this is dimensionless, because you have thermal voltage here. Similarly, you have thermal voltage here. So, this is how one can check for dimensional correctness of expressions. Now, prediction of limiting cases. Let us take a somewhat complicated expression such as this for saturation voltage as an example. We have discussed this point in our previous module, how to check an expression like this with for asymptotic situations or limiting cases, right. So, we have remarked, for example, that one limiting case you can consider is when velocity saturation is, or the saturation velocity is very high, in which case this term, this expression should reduce to that you obtain for the pinch off a MOSFET model based on pinch off condition, right. In other words, it should reduce to only VGS minus VT by alpha. So, you can check that it does indeed happen. Saturation velocity very high is equivalent to saying the EC or critical field for velocity saturation is very high, right. And when that happens, this entire term goes to 0. So, you are left with just 1, this 1 plus this 1 becomes 2 and there is a reciprocal here. So, 2 divided by 2, this is VGS minus VT by alpha. So, you see that we have checked using a limiting case that this expression seems to be fine, at least on that particular checking criterion. Similarly, you can have another check, right. If you know that the term alpha is basically introduced to model the effect of increase of the depletion charge from source to drain, then you know that if you do not take into account this increase of depletion charge from source to drain and assume the depletion charge to be constant from source to drain, your saturation voltage expression will be just VGS minus VT. So, if you set alpha equal to 1, you indeed get VGS minus VT, right. So, alpha is equal to 1 when the depletion width is constant from source to drain, and when alpha is more than 1, your saturation voltage is less than VGS minus VT. This also you can intuitively satisfy yourself based on the observation that when your depletion width varies from source to drain, your depletion charge is more and current would be less, right? So if the saturation voltage is less, your saturation current would be less. So when alpha is more than 1, your saturation voltage reduces, because alpha more than 1 is the representation for depletion width increasing from source to drain. Okay, so this is how you can check for dimensional correctness, and you can check the expression for limiting cases for checking the physical basis of the model. Now, yet another method of ascertaining the physical basis of the solution is to check whether the solution is consistent with the approximations we have made. Let us illustrate this for the MOSFET. So this table represents the all the approximations that we have made for deriving the MOSFET model. So we can take each approximation and check whether the solution we have obtained is consistent with the approximation or does it violate the approximation that we made. Okay. Now this is a fairly detailed exercise. I am going to illustrate only one particular approximation, how we can check its validity. Okay. And I am going to take a very important approximation, that is the gradual channel approximation, for illustration. You can find your own ways of checking other approximations. Now even this, I am not going to go through the detailed validation or checking, but I am going to lay out the steps in which you can check. So this is an assignment for you. Estimate the fraction delta L by L of the channel length L over which the gradual channel approximation GCA is invalid in an NMOSFET, biased at VGS greater than VT and VDS equal to VDS sat equal to VGS minus VT by alpha. So how do you check this? You can check as follows. Now before I tell you the steps in which the approximation is checked, let me recall what we are talking about here. So delta L is the channel length modulation region. Okay. So as we have brought out in a previous module, what is the interpretation of the channel length L in the threshold based model? Channel length L is the region over which GCA or gradual channel approximation is valid. So delta L is the region where it is not valid. Okay. So that is the delta L we are talking about. So you check the approximation in the following steps. Assume that the GCA is valid at a channel position x if at that position d square psi s by dx square is less than 0.1 times space charge rho by epsilon s, okay, where we take the modulus of the space charge. So we normally work with a p-type substrate or n-channel MOSFET. And in the p-type substrate, the space charge is negative, right? So we want to take only the positive part of it to check this particular relation. Note here that psi s is the surface potential. So this talks about the rate of change of the surface potential with distance x along the channel. What we are saying is that if d square psi s by dx square is less than 1/10 of this term rho by epsilon s, then we can assume the rho by epsilon s to be equal to d square psi s by dy square, right? So please recall this gradual channel approximation. This approximation is applied to the Gauss law, where divergence of E is dou by dou x of Ex plus dou by dou y of Ey. Now when you put this in terms of the potential, you get the Poisson's equation. So this term is nothing but dou square psi s by dou x square when you are applying this particular law at the surface. Okay, then this is dou square psi s by dou x square, and this is dou square psi s by dou y square. Okay, but of course you have to put a negative sign here, because when you convert from field to potential, you have the negative sign. Okay. So now, if this term is less than 1/10 of the right hand side, that means this term is 90% of the right hand side. Okay. So that is how gradual channel approximation would be valid. I can neglect this part. So that is the logic of this assumption. Next, to start with, assume the gradual channel approximation to hold, so that the y dimensional surface potential equation can be written as Qi as a function of psi s is given by minus C aux into Vgs minus Vt minus alpha into psi s minus psi s naught. So if you recall, this particular expression was derived assuming the gradual channel approximation, right. So assuming that we can use the one dimensional capacitance formula to relate charge to voltage. Okay. So one dimensional formula along the y direction, that is the vertical direction from gate to bulk. Next, assume the current to be due to drift, so that x dimensional current equation can be arranged as IdS into dx is approximately equal to W into the surface mobility into minus of the inversion charge Qi into d psi s. Now, you make these assumptions, that is, so we are going to assume the gradual channel approximation to be valid, and then we are going to look at what are the results, and then we see how they contradict the assumption of gradual channel approximation. So derive psi s as a function of x by integrating the current equation after substituting Qi psi s from the surface potential equation and assuming the surface mobility to be constant independent of x. Express the result in a compact form in terms of the normalized variables psi s minus psi s naught by Vds sat, x by L and Ids by Ids sat, where Ids sat is given by this particular expression, okay, in terms of Vds sat. In the next step, substitute the surface potential expression, psi s expression derived above into the condition d square psi s by dx square is less than 0.1 into rho by epsilon s, okay. Using rho is approximately equal to minus Qna and Ids equal to Ids sat. Since the device is biased at Vds equal to Vds sat, and then derive the maximum x by L over which the gradual channel approximation is valid to get an expression for delta L by L. Express your result in a physically meaningful form in terms of normalized quantities L by LD and Vds sat by Vt, where LD is the debye length. Part C, estimate delta L by L for L equal to 0.25 micron, substrate doping Na equal to 1 in 10 power 17 per centimeter cube, and the saturation voltage Vds sat equal to 2 volts. So that you can see, for a short channel device with L equal to 0.25 microns, what is the channel length over which the GCA is valid, and therefore how much is the delta L. Now let us return to our slide on testing. We talked about consistency of the solution with approximations, right, so far. Now the next thing we should look for is number of empirical parameters. So if you have a large number of empirical parameters which have to be adjusted in the model to get a match with measurement, then you know that model is not physical. On the other hand, if the number of empirical parameters is small, then the model has a good physical basis. Next, how do you check a model for accuracy? So you compare the model results with accurate simulation. This is one level of checking for accuracy, right. So what is meant by accurate simulation? If you recall, we have talked about the approximation set 1 and 2. So what we said is, you have approximation set 1 which are used while deriving the qualitative model. Okay. So, even as you start deriving a model, you are making approximations, right, about the carrier transport and structure of the device and so on. So, these are approximation set 1. Now, based on the approximation set 1, you come to the equations which are used for modeling the device. These are the 6 equations that we talked about if you are using the drift diffusion model. Then we are using additional approximations, right, that is called approximation set 2, where you approximate these equations, drift diffusion equations, to get an analytical model. Now, if I use these equations without using approximation set 2, then I can get a solution. Now, that is a solution we are talking about here in accurate simulation. So, you will have approximation set 1, no doubt, okay, but then you are not going to use approximation set 2. So, you will use the 6 basic differential equations and use a computer to solve them simultaneously, right, using a numerical solution. So, this is the so called one level of approximate simulation that we are talking about here. So, you compare the numerical solution with the analytical results, right, that way you can check the accuracy of the analytical model. You can use a more deeper check if you check the numerical solution by relaxing approximations of this set. You will have more complicated expressions to be used there, right, but you can improve the, you know, your accuracy of the reference solution with which you are checking the analytical model, and you can then see whether the analytical model is accurate even at a more fundamental level. However, this is not the ultimate check. The ultimate check of a model is comparison of the results with measured data, okay. Since the measured data is difficult to get in many situations, we do accept many times in research a comparison with accurate simulation, right. So, you derived an analytical model, you can compare its results with a accurate numerical model, right, and then you know that will be accepted as some kind of, you know, a test for accuracy, though it will not be regarded as an ultimate test. You see, another reason why numerical simulation is so common is because many times, supposing you have a new device structure and you are developing an analytical model for it, that device structure is not that easy to fabricate, right. So, you have to spend lot of money and effort to fabricate, and you want to show that, you know, your model is actually good in predicting the device characteristics. So, even in such cases, this particular method of checking the accuracy would be acceptable. Now, let us go to the improvement step. The solution is modified to improve one or more of the GCAPS criteria. So, what is the direction of improvement? Once we have tested the model on the GCAPS criteria and we know which are the criteria on which the model is weak, now we can try to strengthen the model on those criteria by introducing some modifications or improvement, okay. So, that is how we improve a model. Now, let us consider an example. Supposing I take the threshold based model, right. I know, for example, that this model fares very badly on the continuity criterion, okay. Why? Because you can see here there are many partitioning voltages. One is VH, another is V dash T, then yet another is VT. And then you have VDS sat, right. So, can I remove these partitioning voltages and make this model continuous? This is what we will try, one approach of doing this to gain continuity. Now, while doing so, we do not want to sacrifice the advantage of this model, and that is all these expressions that you see here are closed form, and computationally this is very simple. The approach we are going to talk about is what is adopted in BSIM or Berkeley simulation model. This is not the only approach of improving the threshold based model, but we will focus on one approach. So, the first step in this approach is to replace the field dependent mobility by a constant mobility mu n naught. Okay. So, this average surface mobility, which had a somewhat complicated expression, though that expression was closed form and computation was not that much, still we want to make it even simpler and just replace it by a constant mobility term. Now, you can ask, but then if you remove some physical effects, how can you get match of the model with measurements? So, this is where we are going to adjust the mobility to get match with the measurement, and there is going to be an empirical element. So, what this means is, whenever we are trying to improve the model on any of the criteria of the GCAPS set of criteria, your model may have to sacrifice its strength on another criterion, right. So, what we are saying now is, I am trying to achieve continuity. Okay. So, when I am trying to achieve continuity, in other words, when I want to strengthen C criterion, the criterion C in GCAPS, I may be losing the physical basis somewhat. Okay. So, to gain something, I lose something, but the loss is not much. So, that is how on all the criteria I can improve, right. That is how my model can be reasonably good at all criteria, right. So, I am removing the some sort of strong weakness of one criterion by sacrificing little bit on another criterion. The next step is simplify the saturation voltage expression. Okay. So, instead of having this complicated term here, I simply remove this complicated term and the factor 2, I end up with this simple expression for saturation voltage. Next, what I do is, I say that my model for VGS is valid for greater than VT instead of greater than VH, right. Now, let me remind you what is the VH and VT here. So, on the VGS axis, you have the voltage VT dash here, VT and VH. Okay. This VT dash to VH is the moderate inversion region. So, we have said that this model, which is for drift current, is strictly valid only in the strong inversion region, right. That is what is this. So, this is strong inversion, this is weak inversion. What we are now saying is, let us use the model up to VT, where we had shown that is inaccurate. But now, what are we going to do? Because we are going to fill in this gap by doing some modification, that modification will improve the accuracy of our model in this regime where it was inaccurate. Okay. And it will allow you to use the model until VT rather than only beyond VH. So, we have removed one partitioning voltage. The next step is to use a smoothing function. And what will this smoothing function do? So, let us illustrate one example of that. To illustrate that smoothing function approach, we have repeated the previous equations here, but with a gap where we can write some more expressions to illustrate the concept of smoothing functions. So, the first step is that I replace the partition VDS sat here. Okay. I compress these two expressions into a single expression by replacing the VDS term by VDS effective term. Okay. Now, what is the relation between this VDS effective and the VDS here? Let us look at that. This relation is first shown on a plot to get an intuitive feel. So, the VDS effective as a function of VDS varies as shown here. What is the property of the shape? So, in this region, the VDS effective is same as VDS. So, this has slope 1, VDS effective is approximately equal to VDS, this straight line. But when you exceed VDS sat, your VDS saturates to VDS sat. This is how this particular term here will automatically saturate once you exceed VDS sat. Okay? Now, that is how it will realize this particular segment, saturation segment. Okay? So, you use the linear segment here and replace the VDS term of the linear segment by an effective drain to source voltage term, which has a shape like this. Okay? Now, that is the trick. It is a very intelligent but very simple approach, okay, to simulate the current from linear to saturation region. Now, you can have a single expression to represent this shape. You do not have to have one expression in this region, another expression to another expression in this region. You do not have to have, you do not need one expression in this region and a different expression in this region, right. So, example of this. So, before I give you the example expression, let us put it down on the slide what we have said. The VDS effective stitches the saturation and non-saturation segments. Okay? It stitches this region and this region. There were two expressions here, these have been compressed into one, that is what we are saying. So, one example of this shape is, one example of an expression that gives you the shape that we talked about is VDS effective equal to VDS sat into 1 plus VDS sat by VDS power m and this whole thing to the power minus 1 by m. I will leave it to you as an assignment to check that this expression indeed gives you the shape. This should not be difficult since you recall that such an expression for used, such an expression was used to represent the velocity versus field relation. Yet another expression which is more interesting is this. So, VDS effective is equal to VDS sat minus 0.5 into VDS sat minus VDS minus an empirically adjustable parameter delta, and then you add a square root term which contains this particular part of this expression VDS sat minus VDS minus delta. You square it plus 4 delta into VDS sat. Okay. Now, what is the role of delta? The role of delta is to sharpen the transition between the so called linear and saturation regions. So, let me illustrate this. The sharpening of this corner is what you achieve. Okay, by either changing this m. So, if your m is high, then this corner here is sharp. Okay. So, similarly, sharpening the corner can also be achieved by reducing the delta parameter here. What kind of delta parameters are used and so on, we will shortly discuss. Okay. Since this expression is the expression that is used in Berkeley simulation model, and it has a property that the computation involved in calculating the VDS effective by this particular expression is much less than the computation involved in calculating VDS effective by this expression, okay, the power law expression. That is why I am going to discuss the derivation of this expression. So, the same expression is laid out here in the slide, creating some space for the derivation. Now what we want is this. The expression is plotted here. How do you get this? Now before we move on to that, we want to show the role of delta. So delta is equal to 0.001, 0.01 and 0.1. This is what is shown here. These are the typical values that are going to be used in practice. So you can see here, as your delta increases, the corner becomes less and less sharp. Smaller the delta, sharper the corner. So now, the first step in the derivation is to represent this particular part of the expression as a function f of VDS. Now what is f of VDS like? So if this is your VDS effective expression, this red line indicates the f of VDS. Okay? All that you are doing is that you are recognizing that f of VDS is the difference between VDS sat and VDS effective. So if you subtract, this is VDS sat, right? So this is your VDS sat. If you subtract the VDS effective, which is a red curve, from this VDS sat, you get the blue curve. So we, let us see how we can get the f of VDS. Consider this particular behavior of modulus of VDS. Now one point I want to make here is that this is an example of the synthesis level of thinking or creative level of thinking, where it will not be so easy to recognize why I should start in a particular manner. Okay? For example, when Planck tried to explain the black body radiation and tried to model the black body radiation, he came up with the principle that you can model the black body radiation only if you assume energy to increase in discrete values and not continuously. And the smallest energy element, right, in this discretization of energy is h into the frequency nu, right, that is called a quantum, Planck's quantum. Now beyond a point, it is not so easy to see how did Planck think about it. Okay? So that is why Planck is regarded as a highly creative person, a genius. So the point I am trying to make is, in every creative product, there will be some step that you cannot explain, right, how the person got it. And that is where lies the novelty or the strength of that idea. Okay? So similarly here, why do you start with a function modulus of VDS? Will not be very clear to you, right? Until I do the derivation. So the person who proposed this, or the set of people who proposed this, that is why, are well respected. In fact, that is the strength of the BC model, right? So this is a creative element in this model. Okay. Now modulus of VDS versus VDS, the plot looks something like this. On the other hand, the VDS versus VDS, that is y equal to x, plot will look something like this. Now let us put this together. This is where you are doing synthesis, right? Let us put this together and let us see the function modulus of VDS minus VDS by 2. How does that look like? So when I subtract VDS from modulus of VDS, this part is same as this part. So when I subtract, I will get 0. This is what you are getting here. On the other hand, when I subtract this from here, right, I am going to get double of this value, and that is why I am doing a division by 2. Then I will get back this particular shape for the negative VDS. Now one thing I want to say is, any synthesis is, the result of synthesis is not unique. There can be multiple solutions when you are using the synthesis approach to arrive at the solution. What we are discussing is one possible solution, right? That is what is important here. So this is not the only way to explain how you get this particular expression. There may be some other way, but this is one very simple way to explain this expression. And also, this expression is not the only expression that can give you VDS effective versus VDS, right? So we have seen that power law expression with the power m can be another approach of getting the VDS effective versus VDS. Okay. Now, next, let us look at this particular function. What is it? This is VDS minus VDS sat, modulus of that, minus VDS minus VDS sat by 2. So what we are doing is, we are taking this form and we are replacing VDS by VDS minus VDS sat. Now you may have difficulty appreciating why am I doing this. That is why you look at it pictorially. Sometimes you can think better using pictures rather than expressions. So what we are trying to do here is that we are trying to shift this function rightward to VDS sat. Why? Because you go back and see what we want to achieve. We want to get this function f of VDS, okay, and this is where you have VDS sat, okay. So to resemble this function, what we have done is we have shifted this function to the right to VDS sat. And when you do this operation intuitively and translate this to an expression, what you are doing is effectively you are replacing VDS by VDS minus VDS sat. That is all what you are doing here. Now you rewrite this particular function as square root of VDS minus VDS sat square. So the modulus of VDS minus VDS sat can be written in one form as square root of VDS minus VDS sat square. Once again, you might ask, so why are we doing this? Well, that is where there is this creativity, right? So we will see where are we going soon. So let us rewrite this same expression here to create some space. All that I have done here is I have interchanged the location of these two terms, okay. I have just rearranged the expression. Now, if you introduce the parameter delta in this expression, you will end up getting this expression, okay. The role of this parameter delta is to round off this particular corner. Now let us compare this expression and this expression. Again, there is a jump here. This is a creative element, okay, cannot be explained that easily. You have to just appreciate this these kind of jumps, right, which you cannot explain very easily. That is why you get the aha feeling. How did someone get it? So you can see here that this 0.5 is this half term, and VDS sat minus VDS minus delta. So we have just introduced a parameter delta within this expression, and the same thing is repeated even here in this expression, right. Now when you do that, you have to add 4 delta VDS sat, okay, so that your expression actually has this same shape but a rounded corner. Again, it is not that easy to just explain why are you adding 4 into delta times VDS sat, right. You can think about it. I will leave it to you as an exercise. Now let us come back to this particular slide on VDS effective with stitches, saturation, non-saturation segments. Next we have to combine the diffusion current and the drift current into one expression somehow. So this way you will be removing another partition. Now how do you do that? So what we are saying is, you simply replace the VGS minus VT term here by an effective function VGST effective, okay. When you do that, your saturation voltage will be written as VGST effective by alpha. This is straightforward for you to see, okay, that if you use this expression, your saturation voltage will be obtained by putting the condition dIDS by dVDS effective equal to 0 at the saturation point, and that will lead you to the condition VGST effective by alpha for saturation voltage. Now, what is this VGST effective term? This approach is similar to replacing VDS by VDS effective to combine the saturation and non-saturation segments. So, the VGST effective versus VGS has the same shape as the drain to source current versus VGS shape from diffusion to drift. So, on a semi-log plot, you recall that the drain to source current versus VGS line is straight, okay, and then it tends to, the rate of increase tends to reduce, where the partitioning voltage Vt is somewhere here. So, we want an expression which has this particular shape. If you get that expression and put it in here, then the result will work for drift as well as diffusion. This particular square law expression without VGST effective, that is with VGS minus Vt, was applicable in this region, okay. So, we are extending the validity of this expression by replacing VGS minus Vt by VGST effective, which will give you this shape, and also there will be continuous variation from drift to diffusion. So, the VGST effectives stitches sub threshold and super threshold segment. This is sub threshold and this is super threshold. Let me tell you what is the expression that is used. It will look somewhat complex, but then we are going to discuss how do you get that expression. The expression for VGST effective is 2n into Vt into logarithm of 1 plus exponential of VGS minus Vt by 2n Vt, divided by 1 plus 2n Cox by Cd into exponential of minus of VGS minus Vt by 2n Vt. Now, before I discuss the derivation of this expression, let me just tell you one small modification, but important modification you have to make, so that the predictions of this model with VGST effective and VDS effective are accurate and continuous. You have to add a 2 Vt term to VGST effective in the VDS sat expression, okay. We will see later why you have to add this 2 Vt term. Let us look at the derivation of this VGST effective. Now, consider the sub threshold and super threshold segments of drain current for VDS much less than Vt. Actually, this is IDS, okay, because we are neglecting gate and bulk currents. Now, what are these expressions? Expressions are given here. For VGS less than or equal to Vt, this is sub threshold, and for VGS greater than Vt, you have the drift current expression, okay. This is super threshold. Now, we are considering the situation VDS much less than Vt, simply because these expressions will become simpler for that condition. We will see how the two expressions can be stitched together, or you can come up with one expression which will give you these segments for these conditions easily for VDS much less than Vt. And then we will show that same expression with very little modification can be also used for VDS much greater than Vt, and therefore for all VDS. So, what is the simplification for VDS much less than Vt? Here you get only the VDS instead of 1 minus exponential VDS by Vt, okay. And here again you get only VDS instead of this expression for instead of this expression, right? So let us see how do you get that. So for VDS much less than VT, this exponential term can be approximated as 1 minus I am sorry, there is no minus here, 1 minus VDS by VT. Now this is nothing but saying that exponential minus x is approximately equal to 1 minus x for x much less than 1. And therefore, if you approximate this exponential like this, 1 minus exponential of minus VDS by VT would be 1 minus this quantity. So this minus sign will go away and this 1 will go away, and you will be only left by, you will only be left with VDS by VT. And this VT then you can cancel with one of the VTs here. That is how you are getting this expression here. So VT square is becoming VT and you are having only the VDS term. Now let us look at this expression. If VDS is much less than VT, this term can be simply removed, because when you square a term that is small, you get an even smaller term, right? And that is why this will be less than this particular term. Okay, this term will be much less than this term. So that is how you are getting this. Okay, now let us look at these two expressions. I can write this diffusion current expression as shown here. So what am I doing? I am dividing the CD term by COX and multiplying by COX. Okay, why am I doing that? Then I can see that this term here becomes the same as this term. So that is my motivation in doing that. Now since this VDS term which is multiplying the expression is common, and this term here is same as this term, now you compare these two terms. Okay, if I can somehow get an expression for VGST effective which will reduce to this expression for VGS less than VT and this expression for VGS greater than VT, then I have solved my problem. So this is really my VGST effective, right? That it should give you this segment for VGS less than VT, VGS less than or equal to VT, and it should give you this segment for VGS greater than VT. So let us rewrite or summarize what we have written just now. So our expression at this point is IDS given by W by L mu n naught into COX into VGST effective into VDS, where VGST effective has this property, right? These are the expressions. Note that this is valid for VDS much less than VT only, but later on we will show that our approach can be extended to VDS much greater than VT. Okay, how do you get a VGST effective which has this form? Consider this particular expression for VGST effective. Here there is an intellectual jump, right? You will ask, no, you know, why are you considering this expression? Now this is where the contribution of the researcher, right? This is something new that gives you aha feeling, oh, I do not understand, right? Exactly how this has been arrived at. That is why this is novel, that is why this particular contribution is valuable. So something that others cannot understand, right, easily, is the contribution of the person who has proposed this equation. Now let me write the same this particular equation in a somewhat simpler form. This is amounts to considering ln of 1 plus e power x. Okay, into some quantity here, right? So we would like to show that this particular expression will give you this for VGS less than VT minus 3NVT and this for VGS greater than VT plus 3NVT. How do we show this? So, we come back to this particular expression and see its behavior, then this will be clear. We would like to show that this VGST effective expression will give you n times Vt into exponential of VGS minus Vt by NVT for VGS less than Vt minus 3NVT, and it will give you VGS minus Vt for VGS greater than Vt plus 3NVT. Okay. Now, how do you show this? So, let us consider this expression ln 1 plus e power x. When x is less than 0, e power x is less than 1. Okay. So, if x is a large negative number, e power x will be actually much less than 1. Okay. In that case, I can write ln 1 plus e power x as approximately equal to 1 plus e power x. I am sorry, you can write this as simply e power x. I am using the approximation ln 1 plus z is approximately equal to z for z much less than 1. Now, for x greater than 0 and if x is a large positive number, then e power x is much greater than 1, then 1 plus e power x is approximately equal to e power x itself, and ln of 1 plus e power x is approximately equal to ln of e power x, that is approximately equal to x. So, that is interesting. This ln of 1 plus e power x for x large negative number is simply e power x. Okay. And for x large positive number, it is x. Now, in this light, if I substitute for x VGS minus Vt by NVT. Why am I substituting VGS minus Vt by NVT? You go back. What kind of VGST effective function we wanted? It has to have this exponential of VGS minus Vt by NVT. Okay? So, that is why the exponent x is being replaced by VGS minus Vt by NVT. Then I can write ln of 1 plus e power x is equal to, that is if this, then this is equal to e power VGS minus Vt by NVT for x less than 0 or large negative number or VGS less than Vt. Okay. And we may be extending it up to Vt, right? If you allow x equal to 0. So, we are getting this particular part of the function exponential of VGS minus Vt by NVT for VGS less than or equal to Vt here. On the other hand, for x greater than or equal to 0, I will get this ln of 1 plus e power x is simply x. That means, I will get VGS that same thing is approximately equal to VGS minus Vt by NVT. So, that is how for VGS greater than 0 is nothing but VGS greater than Vt. Okay. So, that is how I have got this particular expression. I haven't shown you how exactly you get VGS minus VT, because here you have got VGS minus VT by NVT, right? So you have got VGS minus VT in the numerator. Now, since this gives you VGS minus VT by NVT, if I want to get this VGS minus VT, I have to multiply by NVT. Now, that is the reason why I am multiplying this by NVT, okay, here to get VGS minus VT. Okay, that is why you are multiplying the log of 1 plus exponential VGS minus VT by NVT by NVT, so that you can get VGS minus VT as shown here. Then this NVT will cancel. Of course, you will get an NVT term here, but that is not a problem because you are having a VT term here. So, we will see how to work with that. Okay. So, now actually these expressions are valid when x is a large negative number or x is a large positive number, right? So, what is the meaning of large? So, here you can see what we are saying is, if VGS is less than VT minus 3 times NVT. So, in other words, we are putting here x instead of 0, if x is less than minus 3, and VG, and here instead of x greater than 0, x is greater than 3. We know that when x is less than minus 3, this e power x is less than e power minus 3, and then it can be assumed to be much smaller than 1. It will be 1 by 20. E power minus 3 is approximately 1 by 20. So, we have used this criterion even when we wanted to approximate the Fermi-Dirac function, right, by the Boltzmann function, right, Boltzmann approximated Fermi-Dirac function. Similarly, if x is more than 3, this quantity is more than 20, and therefore, we can neglect 1 with 5% error, right. So, that is the logic. So, that is why you have taken here minus 3 NVT and here plus 3 NVT, okay. So, x less than minus 3, where x is VGS minus VT by NVT, gives you the condition VGS minus VT by NVT less than minus 3, and if you shift this NVT here, it becomes VGS minus VT less than minus 3 NVT, and then when you shift VT to the right hand side, it becomes VGS less than VT minus 3 NVT. So, that is how you are getting this. And similarly, you get this condition VGS greater than VT plus 3 NVT. Okay. So, we have explained how you get this particular term from this term, right? How do you get these approximations, these approximate segments from this particular expression. Now, compare this and this. We have got VGS minus VT here, and here, however, when you compare this and this, we have got the exponential term right, we have got the thermal voltage right, but we are getting N here, whereas we should get CD by COX here. So, that is where we have to now introduce one more trick. How do you convert from N to CD by COX? To achieve that, we want to multiply this function by another function of VGS minus VT by NVT, okay, which should reduce to 1 when your VGS is greater than VT plus 3 NVT, so that this particular segment is unaffected, but this function should give you N for VGS less than VT minus 3 NVT. That is the nature of this function. That is what we have written here. For VGS less than VT, this function should be CD by N COX. Okay. So, when this function is CD by N COX, that N and this N will cancel, and then you will get this CD by COX. On the other hand, this function should be simply 1 for VGS greater than VT. So that this part is unaffected, right? This is equal to this, is unaffected. Now, if you have a function like that for f, then you will get instead of n cd by cox here. So, let us consider derivation of this function f. Again, consider a function f1, okay, this is not f yet, this is f1, okay, where you have the exponential function in numerator as well as in denominator. This is again an example of creativity. You know, you cannot easily see, you know, why should you do it, right? That is a novelty here. Again, you get an aha feeling. However, some intuition behind why we should look at this kind of an expression is obtained if you note that it is exponential function which has nice continuity properties. So, if you compose any function that you want using exponential function, that function will have good continuity properties, which is essential for a compact model expression, right? Okay. Now, let us look at this. You want to get cd by n cox, right, ultimately for VGS less than Vt. So, you can see that if VGS is sufficiently less than Vt or sufficiently negative, then this quantity will be exponential, this quantity will be negative, and exponential of negative will be a small number. This exponential of negative quantity will also be a small number, right. Then what will happen is, I can neglect this compared to 1, and then I will end up getting cd by n cox into exponential of Vgs minus Vt by n Vt, okay. If Vgs is greater than Vt, then this quantity will be a large positive number. If Vgs is sufficiently greater than Vt, this will be a large positive number. This also will be large positive number. When this is large, I can neglect 1 compared to this number, and then I will have this exponential term in numerator as well as denominator, which I can cancel, and cd by n cox in the numerator as well as denominator, which also I can cancel, and therefore this will reduce to 1. So, that is what we are saying here. So, this function gives you cd by n cox into exponential Vgs minus Vt by n Vt for Vgs less than Vt minus 3 n Vt. Again, we are using the criterion that exponential of minus 3 is much less than 1 and exponential of 3 is much greater than 1. So, exponential of minus of a quantity more negative than 3 will also give you the required approximation, as you will get the approximation for exponential of a quantity more than 3. Now, you put the term 2 here, right? Why do you do it? Well, before I discuss why we do it, let us see when you put the term 2, what is going to happen, okay. So, you are getting, you are replacing nvt by 2vt. So, here you are getting 2n cox, here you are getting 2nvt, right? Then this particular function will reduce to this particular function. Now, why are we doing this? Because you see that if this function gives you an exponential of Vgs minus Vt term, you are already getting an exponential Vgs minus Vt term from here, okay, when this Vgs minus Vt is very small. So, I will end up getting exponential of something multiplied by exponential of the same thing. In other words, I will get exponential of twice that quantity, whereas I want only exponential of that quantity in my current expression. So, anticipating this issue that when I am multiplying this function by f of Vgs minus Vt by n Vt, I am going to end up getting product of two exponentials, okay, for one particular condition, whereas I should get which is same as saying I will end up getting exponential of twice the quantity, but I want exponential of that quantity. So, therefore, I will divide this by factor of 2, so that if I multiply e power x by 2 by e power x by 2, then I will get e power x, which is what I want. If I multiply e power x by e power x, I will get e power 2x, but I want only x. So anticipating that, I divide by 2. That is why you are dividing here by 2. Okay, so that this leads to an exponential which is suitable for you to derive the ultimate expression. Now I should evidently divide by 2 here also, because only then when I multiply this by this, I will get VGS minus VT by NVT, and if I am doing that, I should multiply this also by 2. Okay. Now you can see that this particular thing that we have derived is same as this VGST effective expression, okay, that we said the Berkeley simulation model uses. Okay. Now with that, we have come to the end of our lecture. So what is the summary? Let us summarize our Berkeley simulation model. We said that this model is given by IDS is equal to W by L into mu n naught into C aux into VGST effective into VDS effective minus alpha by 2 into VDS effective square. This is same as the square law model, simple square law model, with VDS replaced by VDS effective function and VGS minus VT replaced by a VGST effective function, right? And what are these functions? So VGST effective has this particular form, and VDS effective has this particular form. And what is the behavior of VGST effective and VDS effective? So VGST effective versus VGS has the same shape as the IDS versus VGS, right? When you do a semi-log plot where this is log scale, y-axis is on a log scale. And similarly, VDS effective versus VDS has the same shape as IDS versus VDS behavior for any given VGS, right? So it rises linearly and then saturates. Where the VDS sat term used in VDS effective function is given by VGST effective plus 2 VT by alpha. Now I have not explained why you add this term to VT, to VGST effective, okay. I am going to leave that as an exercise for you to figure out, you know. I have explained to you how do I use the VGST, how do I derive the VGST effective and VDS effective, right. So you can use that experience to figure out why I should add 2 VT here. So note that the nice thing about this Berkeley simulation model is it uses simple expressions, and these are all continuous across all regimes. There are no conditions like an expression is valid for less than some value and another expression is valid for more than some value and so on, right? That is a nice thing about this particular model.